Hello and welcome to our new video on cryptography for everybody. Do you think that a machine can detect the type of cipher? Imagine you have a ciphertext that has been encrypted using an unknown cipher. Having a machine that can give you the answer which type of cipher has been used only by providing the ciphertext, wouldn't this be great? In the next 10 minutes, you learn that this actually works, that there can be a machine that tells you the type of a cipher. We structured the video into four different parts. In the first part, we will discuss the cipher type detection problem. After that, you will learn the basics of artificial neural networks and here in particular, feed-forward networks, since we will use these to detect the type of ciphers. After that, we will discuss in detail a cipher type detection network approach. And finally, we will have a look at NCID, the neural cipher identifier that we built and that allows the identification of unknown cipher types. The cipher type detection problem. One of the main problems having a ciphertext is the unknowledge of the used cipher, what we called the cipher type. And cryptanalysts use statistical measures to find out this type of cipher. For instance, you can use ladder distribution in the ciphertext and check if it equals to the plaintext ladder distribution of plaintext. This may lead to a transposition cipher. Then having no double letters in the ciphertext and for instance missing letter J, so that we have no letter J in the ciphertext, could lead us to a Playfair cipher. And of course, the index of coincidence, IOC, can distinguish between mono and polyalphabetic ciphers. And there are many more statistical measures that cryptanalysts actually use to determine the type of a cipher. But often, cryptanalysts can only test using many solvers via trial and error to test if a ciphertext was encrypted using a specific cipher. So, at this point, we thought there has to be another approach. Maybe a machine could help us to solve this problem. And the basic question is, could a machine tell us the cipher type so that we don't need to perform all the statistical measures? And machine learning, for instance, artificial neural networks, we will learn what this is on a later slide, helps us with classification problems. For instance, here on the right side, we have a model of an artificial neural network that can detect if a picture contains a cat. How does this work? The picture of the cat is given to this network here. You can see this network. How this works, we will see on a later slide. Then, through this network, the data flows to the end of the network, and then the network tells us this is a cat. This is, of course, very simplified, but in detail or in principle, this works like this. Now let's understand the cipher type detection problem also as such a classification problem. And let's use artificial neural networks to teach them different cipher types. And let's use statistical values as so-called features for artificial neural networks. That means instead of giving an image to an artificial neural network, we will give a ciphertext to the neural network, then the neural network will work, and in the end it will tell us, for instance, that this ciphertext here was encrypted using the Visionaire cipher. But first, let's have a look at the basics of artificial neural networks or feed-forward networks so that we understand how these work. And the main question here is, what is a feed-forward network? And the answer is that the feed-forward network is one architecture, there are many, for artificial neural networks. But it's a quite simple but yet powerful architecture that we can use for detection of cipher types. So our network consists of several neurons, and a neuron, you can see on the right side, consists of input signals, an output signal, weights, a bias, and an activation function. How does this all work together? You can see here on the right side our neuron. It's usually depicted as just a circle. And in this neuron, we have our activation function. Then we have inputs that are going into the neuron, here I1, I2, and it goes to IN, so we can have N different inputs. And we have different outputs, but all these outputs have the same value at the end. All these inputs and outputs are just numbers. And a neuron gets all its inputs from previous neurons, like you can see here below. We will discuss this later. So let's assume we have our inputs here. Then the activation function is computed over these inputs. There exist different activation functions. Let's assume that we just multiply all our values, or that we concatenate these values in some way. And then the activation function activates when all these values reach a threshold. That means that it then returns an output value. If it is not activated, there are no output values provided by this neuron. Now let's speak about layers. A feed-forward network consists of multiple layers, and each layer has multiple parallel neurons. You can see an example for this here. We have a so-called input layer. Then we have a hidden layer. Usually these networks have between 1 and n hidden layers, so you can have a lot of hidden layers. And then we have an output layer. And creating such a feed-forward network with several layers is referred to as deep learning. And usually each layer is fully connected with the previous and next layer of the network. That means that this neuron is connected to all the previous neurons and all to the following neurons. And this also, and this also, and this also. And signals go through this network from the left to the right. Finally, the network is trained with many input and corresponding output data. Usually we use millions of data to train such a network. How this training works, we will see on the next slide. Here's the basic idea how we train feed-forward networks. First, before we can train a network, we have to obtain or generate training and test data sets. And the feed-forward network is usually initialized with random weights. So each of these lines here connecting the neurons that provide the inputs to the next neuron have these weights here. And these weights have usually random values at the beginning. Also, the bias that's also set to 1 can have a random weight assigned to it. And how do we train now this neural network? First, a single data set, input data, is given to the network from the left. So we input some data, and then it goes through this network to the output layer. And then the generated output data and the expected output data are compared. Let's assume this network here is for the detection of cat images. And this here, when this output neuron fires, it means this is a cat image. So when we put in a cat image on the left side, we assume, or we want this network to output this neuron, or that this neuron here fires, telling us this is a cat. Of course, with random values, all the other neurons, for instance, for dog, for sheep, for cow, and so on, will also fire. But we compare these, and then we use so-called backpropagation. That means we go in the reverse order through the network and adapt our weights in such a way that the output neuron is then a cat. And we repeat steps 1, 2, 3 with all training data that we have. So we put in our cat images, we see here, okay, this has to be cat, then we go backwards, forward, backwards, forward, backwards. So when we train our network with backpropagation, we know the inputs and we know the outputs. The idea is then, when we gave 1 million cat images to this network with our training data, and then we have our test data that are also cat images that the network had never seen before, that it still can detect this is a cat image. So we use the test data to verify if this network actually works. And the accuracy of the network is tested, as I said, using a test data set. And the network is retrained until we reach a value below a target error rate. Of course, it could happen that we give a cat image to that network and this network cannot recognize this as a cat. But if it only happens in 1% or 5% of all the cases and 95% of all cats are detected correctly, then we are, for instance, happy. Now let's have a look how a cipher type detection neural network could work. And to do so, we modeled different features of ciphers, which cryptanalysts usually use to identify them. So what is a feature? Instead of giving the raw data, for instance, the image or the ciphertext directly to the network, we put an intermediate layer between the network and the image or the ciphertext. And then this intermediate layer computes our features, for instance, unigram frequencies, bigram frequencies, the index of coincidence, or just the question, has this ciphertext a letter J, has this ciphertext double letters, and so on. We compute all these features for a given ciphertext, and then we give these features, you can see this below here, to the network. And we did this, and we trained the networks that we created with millions of ciphertexts, and we trained all ACA cipher types. The ACA is the American Cryptogram Association, and the ACA defined 55 different cipher types, and our network knows all of these cipher types. And we created different artificial neural networks and gave the features, as I described these, to these. We call this feature engineering. So you engineer the feature, these features are then given to the neural network, and the neural network then detects the type of the cipher. For instance, here in this example, I colored the different neurons that are active in our example. For instance, we have here a Playfair, no, this is a Visionaire encrypted text. We compute the letter frequencies. Of course, these are more than these three neurons, so for instance, 26 or even more neurons, depending on the width, if we use 1 gram, 2 grams or so. Then we have the feature has the letter J, and then we have the feature has double letters. And as you can see, the letter frequencies add to the result, but the has J and has double not. Then we have our hidden layer that connect our input and output layer. And finally, the Visionaire neuron that tells us this is a Visionaire cipher fires, but also that this is a Playfair cipher neuron fires, but only gives an output of 20%. The nice property of these feedforward networks are that we can create some kind of percentage value at the end. So our network tells us this is by 80% or with a probability of 80% a Visionaire cipher, and this is by 20% a Playfair cipher. Of course, sometimes you have ambiguous answers. So the network could tell you 50-50, or it could generate an output over all the ciphers. But in many cases, these networks or this network here gives us a good answer. So as I said, we also created different artificial neural networks and also gave the ciphertext directly to these. So we omitted the features here and we directly gave the ciphertext as input to the neural network. And this is referred to as feature learning because then the deep learning process or the networks, the artificial neural network, learns by itself these features. And finally, after creating feature engineering networks or feature engineering based networks and feature learning based networks, we also combined all different architectures and used majority voting to increase the overall accuracy. So instead of giving a ciphertext only to one network, we give it to different kinds of networks, and then all these networks come to a final answer by majority voting. And this also increased the accuracy of our machine learning approaches of our networks. Now, after we know the basics of artificial neural networks and feedforward networks, let's have a look at NCID, our neural cipher identifier in CrypTool-Online. Right now, NCID's accuracy is nearly about 83% for all ACA ciphers. So when you give a ciphertext encrypted with one of the ACA ciphers to these neural networks, they should answer in 83% of the cases correctly. So let's have a look at CrypTool-Online and NCID. I'm here now at CrypTool-Online on the CrypTool webpage. I will link the page below this video so that you can also test the NCID classifiers by yourself. And now I want to present some ciphers and how NCID actually detects these. I prepared some example ciphertexts. So let's start, for instance, with the plain text here, meaning we have no ciphertext at all. NCID also is able to detect this. When you're on the page, you have this ciphertext text input field. You just mark this and you paste your cipher into this. By the way, we trained these networks or these machine learning architectures in the background with ciphertext of length 100. If you want to know the details behind this NCID system, you can go here to description. So as I said, I pasted the plain text here. This is, by the way, this text here, but I made it uppercase and removed all spaces. And I pasted it into the ciphertext window here. With architecture, you can select which architectures should be used for testing or classifying this type of cipher. And when you click here on analyze, it will send this to the neural networks. And our neural networks tell us that this is by 75% a plain text. As you can see here, these gray boxes, these are categories. Sometimes you get, for instance, a transposition cipher that is the EMSCO cipher, but it was in fact the columnar transposition cipher. We therefore merged all the transposition cipher in a transposition cipher group. Then at least the transposition cipher group should be on top of the list here and give you a hint that this is actually a transposition cipher. Speaking of transposition cipher, my next example is a transposition cipher. Just copy it and I paste it into NCID and I let this analysis rerun. And here is such an example. I encrypted this text using a columnar transposition cipher, but our networks tell us that the nihilist transposition and cardenus are or have higher probability. We can now, for instance, only test the feed-forward network. And the feed-forward network is the one that insists on cardenus cipher. So you can test different types of networks. For instance, the transformer network has a higher or tells us there's a higher probability that is a columnar transposition cipher. But usually you should just combine all the networks and then in most of the cases or many cases, the correct answer will appear here. Now let's test the next cipher type. This is a visionaire cipher. And I encrypted the same plain text using the different ciphers here. So let's click analyze. And here we see 38% polyalphabetic cipher, and it's 15% sure it's a visionaire cipher. So the visionaire is here in the polyalphabetic ciphers group on the first place, but it could also be a Polybius square substitution. But overall, our system is sure that with higher probability sure that this is a polyalphabetic substitution cipher. Let's test the next cipher type. And the Playfair cipher is a cipher that has a very high success rate. So let's analyze this. And yeah, as I said, it tells us this is a Playfair cipher and it's sure, or the probability is around 75%. So Playfair ciphers can be detected very reliably using NCID. Let's test the next one. It's the Gronsfeld cipher. And with the Gronsfeld cipher, it's the same. It detects it by, or it tells us that with a probability of about 70%, this cipher here is a Gronsfeld cipher. Keep in mind that these texts are quite short, only 100 letters. Now we have a Porter cipher. And here also 63% Porter cipher, this is also correct. And the last we have three left. The Railfence cipher. This is some kind of transposition cipher. And here it tells us it's Redefence or Railfence. So it's very close to the correct answer. But it's sure that this is a transposition cipher. Now let's have a look at the EMSCO cipher. And here again, 65% it is sure that this is an EMSCO cipher. And finally, you have fractionated Morse cipher. And it's 62% sure that this is a fractionated Morse cipher. I think this is quite impressive. So we trained these networks with millions of ciphertexts of such type, and it learned the features of these networks with feature engineer, where we told the networks which features it has to look at. And with feature engineering, and with feature learning, it or these networks automatically learned the important features of these cipher types. And I think this could be, or this can be quite helpful if you have an unknown cipher type. You can just paste your cipher text into this form here and then analyze it to get an idea of which type of cipher could have been used to encrypt your text. In future work, we want to extend these neural networks to more ciphers. We want to not only use the ACA ciphers, we want to go to more historical used ciphers. So, for instance, more homophonic substitution ciphers and so on. And maybe we can also go to a point where these could, for instance, solve these ciphers. But this is future work. Right now we are working on the cipher type detection problem. Yeah, and this is everything I wanted to show you in this video. I think this is quite helpful. And you learned how artificial neural networks work and how these can be used to detect the type of ciphers. If you like what I do, please give a thumbs up. And if you did not yet subscribe to this channel, please do so. This really helps us to grow the channel and to make the CrypTool project, for instance, like CrypTool-Online and NCID, more popular. So thank you very much for watching and see you in the next video.